A warm welcome to Expert Hour. Today's topic is Help, I'm Dizzy, Navigating the Canadian Healthcare System. Balance and Dizziness Canada supports, inspires, and educates those affected by balance and dizziness disorders. We're the only organization in Canada that provides ad-free, up-to-date, evidence-based information about balance and dizziness disorders from a Canadian perspective. As a nonprofit society and registered charity, Balance and Dizziness Canada is funded entirely by donations and memberships. We're delighted to have registered audiologist Erica Zaia with us today. Erica will talk about which healthcare professionals play a role in reaching a diagnosis and deciding on a management plan for vestibular disorders. Erica has done vestibular testing and rehabilitation for 25 years. She had intense training in vestibular assessment and rehabilitation during 8 years of education to complete her bachelor's, master's, and clinical specialization in audiology. Erica regularly attends international courses and conferences in the field. She has worked in a variety of settings, including St. Paul's Hospital in Vancouver and the Royal National Throat, Nose, and Ear Hospital in London, England, as well as public and private practices in Brazil. Erica sees clients at her audiovestibular clinic in Vancouver and is president of Balance and Dizziness Canada. And now for Erica's presentation.
So when we say help, I'm dizzy, one of the most important things that I want to highlight today for you is that dizziness has many different flavors. And it is different for everyone. And it is sometimes not just the word dizziness. Sometimes it is lightheadedness. There is no movement to you. You don't necessarily feel that you are moving in any way, but there is sometimes lightheadedness, sometimes heavy-headedness. Sometimes you feel as though there's a change in vision and you're having difficulty focusing, or you feel like there's a strain on your eyes. It may feel like it is your vision that is having a problem. Other times you can have the true vertigo, which is spinning dizziness in the English language. Sometimes there can be no dizziness at all. There can be just a sensation of imbalance, unsteadiness, that you're not sure-footed, that you feel as though you cannot walk straight. Note that all of these words are symptoms and not a diagnosis. Sometimes when doctors tell you, oh, you have a vertigo, do not take this as a diagnosis. This is just the name of spinning dizziness in many ways. You probably already know if you have spinning dizziness that you have spinning dizziness.
Erica, you should be able to turn on your camera.
Oh, okay. Let me. There you are. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Joyce. So again, know that these are symptoms and not a diagnosis. And so you are going to be after a diagnosis, trying to understand where these symptoms are coming from. Where do they stem from? How did they come about in your body? And the idea will be to then understand what is happening in this system. So the balance system is a very complex system in our body. And I always say that it is two or three times more complex than hearing or vision. Our brains receive the primary information from the inner ear sensors for balance as to where we are in space. The inner ear sensors for balance that are inside the bone here behind our ear, they tell our brain the position of our body 24/7. Even if you are sleeping, if someone would sneak into your bedroom and very slowly and softly pull your bed, your inner ear sensors would alert your brain that you're being moved. So that system is constantly sending information up to the brain, but the brain also uses information from vision and from skin, muscles, and joints. So then the brain really knows what we are doing and where we are in space. When someone feels dizzy, lightheaded, unsteady, imbalanced, you can be sure that there is a problem in any of these four parts. It is either your inner ear sensors for balance or how it is connecting to the vision, the rest of the body, and the brain. And the brain as headquarters plays a very important role in all of this. So you are after the understanding of how is it in this system that dizziness or imbalance or unsteadiness was generated. How did it come about? And who are the professionals that can help you figure that out and address that for your specific case? Again, that's the goal. The goal is diagnosis, because then when you know what you have, it is that idea that if you can name it, you can tame it, name it, understand it, come up with a treatment and a management plan, and then you know what you can expect from this. So again, who are the professionals who can help? Chances are that in the Canadian medical system, you are either going to go see your family doctor or an emergency physician with your dizziness and imbalance disorders, particularly when you are first experiencing your symptoms. If it is the first time ever that, say, strong dizziness spell hits you, you are going to go for the emergency physician. Their role is primarily to rule out any serious causes for that. Most of the times they are after something that would be life-threatening. And so depending on your age, and even in young people, you would be concerned and they would be concerned about whether you're having a stroke or whether you're having a heart attack, which is less common, but more commonly, whether you're having a stroke, whether there is a condition that is life-threatening at that point in time, particularly in the emergency room. Your family physician is going to be after general causes for your dizziness, such as low or high blood sugar, heart diseases, other neurological disorders, and other metabolic issues that could be causing you to have dizziness. Sometimes it is a fact of you're having more than one medication and medications are interacting with each other and they are causing you to feel woozy or lightheaded. Your doctor is going to be the one who will stop and take a look at those general health causes for dizziness. These doctors often try symptomatic medication. If you're having nausea and vomiting, they will prescribe you Gravol or ondansetron. And when you're having dizziness in Canada, betahistine, which goes by the brand name Cirque, is often prescribed to see if it helps alleviate the symptoms for you. In many, many cases, symptoms go away, respond to medication, either go away only on its own or sometimes with the help of the medication, but then for most people, symptoms subside and go away. When that's the case, then you're thankful and then life goes on. But sometimes symptoms persist. And in that case, it is up to your family doctor to refer you to specialists who can start digging deeper into what is happening with you and start helping you manage your symptoms, understand them, or treat them accordingly. Who are those specialists? The first one that many people get referred to because of the nature of the balance system is to an otolaryngologist. Short name is the ear, nose, and throat doctor. Most ear, nose, and throat doctors are generalist specialists in the sense that they don't have any particular interest or particular training in either the ear or the nose or the throat. And they will take care of general and commonly seen dizziness and vertigo diagnosis. They may not be specialized in the ear, and they may not be able to help you if there is a very specific dizziness concern. So they diagnose the most common vestibular disorders, and usually, again, you get to the specialist by the referral of your GP. This expense is usually covered by your provincial plan, if you are in BC, or MSP, as we call it. But again, this is covered by your provincial health plan. When that generalist ENT feels as though your diagnosis may be more complex than just a general ear, nose, and throat diagnosis, they may refer you to an ear specialist in the ENT field. Those doctors are called otologists or neuro-otologists, and they look at the ear and their connections to the brain. For more complex disorders, this is the specialist you're after. They have had additional training to really specialize in those disorders. Usually, a referral to those professionals comes from a neurologist or the generalist ENT. Again, it is just taking the specialty to a second subspecialty, usually also covered by your provincial plan. Sometimes, depending on how the dizziness symptoms present, your GP may refer you directly to a neurologist. And again, professionals who deal with the disorders of the brain and the central nervous system. They also have a diverse range of interests, and so hopefully your family doctor is going to refer you to someone who is a neurologist interested in dizziness and balance disorders. Not all neurologists are, and so for instance, you would see here in BC, some neurologists only seeing cases of MS, multiple sclerosis, other neurologists being particularly interested in dizziness and in migraines or headaches, for instance. And so you may want to discuss this with your GP, whether you are able to find a neurologist who has an interest in dizziness and balance disorders. This expense is usually also covered by your provincial plan. Going also to subspecialties, you may be referred to a neuro-ophthalmologist. It is a specialized eye neuro doctor. So it is a doctor who looks at your eyes, and it is connections to the brain. And so it's not necessarily a doctor who is interested in how much you can see, but how is the processing of your vision by the brain. So for instance, if you have a double vision, if that double vision is coming from a brain disorder, those also usually get either a referral from a GP or from another specialty. So say for instance, some ear, nose, and throat doctors can refer to a very specialized neuro-ophthalmologist to address very specific vision issues and vision concerns, as well as extremely abnormal eye movements that we can see that can occur in certain dizziness and balance disorders. So there are, you may have heard of the word nystagmus, which is an involuntary eye movement. So sometimes it is a consistent eye movement that needs to be addressed then by a neuro-ophthalmologist. Again, it is usually covered by the provincial plan. On the other hand, on the non-medical side, you will often see GPs referring patients to physiotherapists or occupational therapists. And sometimes even as a common sense, many people have learned and have heard that physiotherapists may help with the balance disorders and with the dizziness. Some physiotherapists and occupational therapists have pursued special additional postgraduate training in vestibular disorders, and that part is key. It is key for physiotherapists, and when I talk about audiologists, it is the same. In the graduate training of physiotherapists and occupational therapists, they have very little training in vestibular disorders. You are going to be after a professional who has invested time and effort in really going deeper into the understanding of the vestibular system in order to be able to provide you with an expert opinion on a clinical assessment and come up with a rehabilitation plan for you. Mind you here that physiotherapists do clinical assessments, and the rehabilitation is often based on your clinical presentation. Physiotherapists usually do not do diagnosis of the inner ear sensors for balance. We'll get there when we talk about the role of the vestibular audiologist in this. So the physiotherapist will and may have goggles on your eyes to help with their clinical assessment, and they will come up with a rehabilitation plan for you if you are a candidate for vestibular rehabilitation. Again, expert professionals will be able to tell you whether you are or are not a good candidate for vestibular rehabilitation, because not all dizziness and balance disorders are good candidates for vestibular rehab. Our next webinar is going to be with a physiotherapist, and he'll talk about vestibular rehabilitation. So stay tuned for that one. But you will see and you will learn that not all dizziness disorders particularly are good candidates for vestibular rehab. Physiotherapists usually do not need a referral. You can self-refer to a professional. And on our website, you can find a directory of physiotherapists and occupational therapists who do have advanced training in vestibular disorders. And we recommend you to seek professionals, again, who are qualified, who have good additional training. Some third-party payers do require a referral, sometimes for physiotherapists, and that can be done by your GP usually. In some provinces, there might be coverage for vestibular rehabilitation. In Ontario, there are some physiotherapists in public hospitals who offer vestibular rehab. Here in BC, we have physiotherapists in falls prevention clinics in some of the hospitals, and those would be covered by the provincial plan. But most physiotherapists are either private or will take your third-party payment, either from an extended healthcare plan, or say, if you have suffered an accident and you are having expenses covered by ICBC or your car insurance company, they may pay for the expenses with a physiotherapist or occupational therapist. Vestibular audiologists, and I am in this group here, in this category. Who are we? We are professionals, again, who had special training, additional postgraduate training in vestibular assessment and management. Our college, the BC, again in BC, our provincial college regulates the professionals who work in vestibular audiology, making sure that we do have the necessary training for this particular specialty. In other provinces, there is no regulation from the college, but usually it is professionals who have also taken the time and the effort to learn a lot more about the vestibular system and have additional training in performing the assessment and performing management of vestibular disorders. We perform a highly specialized diagnostic testing for the inner ear sensors for balance and for your balance system. The way that I describe this is that much in the same way that I can put you in a soundproof booth, present sounds and measure your hearing, I can use very specialized equipment and through head movements, body movements, and other means of stimulating you also with loud sounds, we can measure how much each inner ear sensor for balance is working and whether they're working or not. And as you can imagine, this will give you a very good idea of what you can expect as far as rehabilitation goes. It can provide your doctors, your specialists who are assessing you and taking care of you, it can help them understand what is happening with your inner ear and with your vestibular system. And again, help guide your management plan. Also help you understand what you can expect in terms of your management plan. In the public system, in most provinces in Canada, for you to have a vestibular testing done by an audiologist, you do need a referral from a medical doctor, either from an ear, nose, and throat doctor or from a neurologist. It has to come from a specialist to the vestibular audiologist. In the public system, this expense is covered by your provincial plan. In some provinces in Canada, there are audiologists working in the private sector. We have some here in BC, we have some in Quebec, we have some in Ontario, but not say in the Atlantic provinces. We don't have audiologists in private, but in the provinces where there are audiologists doing vestibular testing in the private sector, you do not need a referral. But then it is not covered by your provincial plan. This is going to be usually an out-of-pocket expense for you. Audiologists can also do vestibular rehabilitation. This is an area in which vestibular audiologists and physiotherapists have some overlap. And that is a service that you can access, again, through a physiotherapist as well as through a vestibular audiologist. Obviously, vestibular audiologists will take care of vestibular rehabilitation, but for instance, will not take care of your musculoskeletal issues. They will not manipulate your neck, and they will not do any other manipulation of your neck or your muscles, because this is only within the scope of practice of a physiotherapist. But again, there are vestibular rehabilitation exercises that can be provided by either the vestibular audiologist and the physiotherapist. Now, going a little bit outside of just the ear and the brain, there are other classes of healthcare professionals who may help you in your journey, not only through diagnosis of your dizziness and balance disorders, but also in the management of your dizziness and balance disorder. Psychiatrists may be involved and may be beneficial to you when there is a mental health concern associated with your dizziness and balance disorders. It might be that you have always had a mental health concern, but it might be that this mental health concern arises from having dizziness and balance disorders. And this can happen. It can happen that dizziness really throws you a curveball, that this might be something that creates anxiety or induces you to have, to feel discouraged and to have low energy and to feel as though you are helpless or hopeless. And so those mental health concerns that, again, are either caused by or newly developed with your dizziness disorder, or it may be that you have had something prior that then gets exacerbated by your dizziness. Again, it might be beneficial to you to see a psychiatrist. A psychiatrist is a medical doctor, and they can not only diagnose your mental health concern, but also prescribe medications. They can also do psychotherapy with you. Again, you know, in an attempt at understanding your mental health concern and managing it in the best way possible. You would access psychiatrists by the referral usually from another medical doctor, either your family doctor or another specialist. And again, as medical doctors usually are, this expense would be covered by your provincial plan. On the other hand, in a non-medical doctor, you would find a psychologist. A psychologist is someone with a doctorate degree in psychology. They are not a medical doctor, but they are a doctor in psychology. They can also assess and treat mental health concerns, but they do not prescribe medications in Canada. You often do not need a referral to see these professionals because they are usually not covered by the medical plan, your medical provincial plan. You may have coverage through your third party plan, such as your extended medical plan. And so again, you don't need a referral. Usually psychologists, again, provide you a diagnosis and work with you through psychotherapy as a means to help you manage your mental health concerns that may be associated with dizziness and balance disorders. You may also get the help of registered clinical counselors. Those are usually professionals who have a master's degree, but some have a doctorate degree in counseling. And their idea, rather than diagnosing you and labeling your mental health concern or labeling what is a diagnosis as far as medical, as a medical diagnosis of, say, for instance, anxiety or an obsessive compulsive disorder, this is not something that counselors do, but they focus on the relational process. They have competencies that facilitate human change, human behavior and human change. It is in that relationship with the counselor that you then develop a greater awareness of your behavior, of your patterns of behaviors, of your emotions, your feelings, and your thoughts, and that you can modify those in order to live a healthier life. You do not also need a referral to clinical counselors. And again, they are not covered by your medical provincial plan. You would, again, sometimes access coverage by a third-party payer or as an out-of-pocket expense for you. So one of the things that I left to the question and answers, and I would be happy to take any questions, but a few questions that came to us and that come to us often is about wait lists. And how do you go about the sometimes very lengthy wait lists that you face within the public system more often than not? So sometimes what happens is that you see your family doctor, and currently family doctors may be seeing you not in person and just as a virtual consultation. And then you may face some wait for that. Then you may face some wait, and it can go up to a year or 2 years time for you to get to a specialist, not a generalist ear, nose, and throat doctor, but if you need a neuro-otologist, here in BC, it may take you from 1 to 3 years for you to get to a neuro-otologist. It may take you a little bit less, as I say, up to 4 or 6 months for you to see a generalist ear, nose, and throat doctor. And one of the things that we recommend to patients that we say can be useful is to call that office when you are referred and kindly ask them to be put on a cancellation list. Here in BC, this works more often than not, that when you ask to be placed on a cancellation list, that you then are able to get in sooner than the expected wait time. Sometimes, as I say, seeing another specialist and being referred to a subspecialty by an already specialist can get you in sooner. So for instance, if you get referred to a neuro-otologist by a generalist ENT, that referral can go through quicker than if going through your GP. So there are sometimes a few hoops that you can jump and that you should try and jump in order to reduce your wait times. Another hurdle that some of patients may experience is the wait for vestibular audiology in the public sector. Again, in many provinces, there are no private audiologists, but in some provinces where there are private audiologists, you may get in sooner through private audiologists. This is the case in BC, and it is the case in Ontario, for instance, that you can get into a private audiologist quickly than you can get into a public audiologist. And so sometimes there are ways in which you can try and reduce your wait time. Another thing that I want to highlight again is the health professional directory on our website, where you can find for those professionals who require, who should have additional postgraduate training, such as the physiotherapists, occupational therapists, and audiologists, you will find a curated list of professionals with additional training on our health professional directory on our website. We are in the process of expanding this from BC to the whole country, and we hope to get many more professionals there. If you are watching this webinar and you have a qualified professional who you've seen in the past and know that they are qualified, that they are good, they are experienced in dizziness and balance disorders, direct them to our website. We would be happy to have them listed in our directory, because this again helps people who are dealing with these disorders and in desperate need to find a professional. I have another. Okay. I cannot talk about specific conditions, but I do have a question here. So who would be the professional to see about migraine-associated vertigo or vestibular migraine? You will find, again, specialists in each profession who are more specialized, who have taken an interest in vestibular migraine. So you will find a neuro-otologist who are knowledgeable in vestibular migraine. It is less common for a generalist ear, nose, and throat doctor to know and to manage vestibular migraine, but some generalist ENTs do know, do diagnose, and are comfortable managing this. Within the neurology category, you will also find some neurologists have an interest in headaches, in headache disorders, and you would expect that a neurologist who has an interest in headaches, that they will have interest and training in dealing with migraines. And in the recent years, many more neurologists do know about vestibular migraines and would be able to offer you a perspective. Neuro-ophthalmologists are also usually knowledgeable with regards to vestibular migraines. And again, some other specialists in vestibular disorders, some physiotherapists may be knowledgeable in headaches. Many physiotherapists are not. Many physiotherapists do have more of an interest in balance and in dealing with your muscles and your joints, and do not necessarily have an interest and more knowledge in vestibular migraines slash headaches. But you may find physiotherapists who are. But I would say primarily you are after a specialized ear, nose, and throat doctor, a specialized neurologist, and or a specialized neuro-ophthalmologist. It does take knowing about migraines to know and to diagnose and manage vestibular migraines. I would be happy to take more questions from you. If you go onto your Q&A and you open it up, and there's a box there where you can type questions for me, and I would be happy to take them if you have any more. No? So one of the things that I also want to say is, again, speaking of the role of each profession, you will notice that some professionals are specialized and can diagnose certain conditions. Usually the medical doctor is the one who will, for instance, say to you, and I will use a very common vestibular disorder called Meniere's disease. It is up to a medical doctor to say to you, I think that what you're having sounds, presents like Meniere's disease. That doctor, usually the ear, nose, and throat doctor, is going to be the one who is going to manage your, for instance, your medications for Meniere's disease. It is the one who is likely going to order an MRI for you to rule out that it isn't anything else more sinister as opposed to Meniere's disease. But in your care, you may also very well have an audiologist and a vestibular audiologist. And the role of that professional will be, if you have a hearing loss that is occurring as a result of Ermenier's disease, the audiologist may fit a hearing aid for you on that affected side. And you may have a vestibular audiologist who may be able to conduct a variety of tests that will then support the diagnosis of Meniere's disease by the doctor. There are patterns of test results that the vestibular audiologist can and will determine and will provide that to the ear, nose, and throat doctor so the ENT can say, yes, it is presenting like Meniere's disease. But you may also very well have in your team a counselor, because you may have noticed, you may notice that every time you have a major stressor in your life, it triggers a Meniere's disease attack. And you may be suggested that you see a counselor to help you manage stress. None of us can avoid stress in our life. We cannot be on vacation. We cannot now just simply end our pandemic, but we can learn perhaps with the help of a counselor to become a little bit more resilient to stress. We can learn and we can add tools in our toolbox and manage stress in a healthier way, and therefore reducing the risk of having a Meniere's attack caused by stress. And you may also have a physiotherapist in your team if with Meniere's disease and with a lot of tension and with your stress, you may have neck concerns, or you may have lost a little bit of your shape, your fitness, and you want to introduce exercise. So you may enlist the help of a physiotherapist in your team. So these professionals are not necessarily meant to be the one and only person you're going to have. Because of the nature of the balance system, you may need, and it may be highly beneficial to you, to have a team of people who help you manage, particularly for conditions that are chronic, that will need management. And Meniere's disease is one, but vestibular migraine is another one. You are going to be after a team of people who will help you manage your condition. Managing a chronic condition is not an easy feat. And if you can surround yourself with a team of professionals who you trust, who know you and who take good care of you, will be your goal. And I can see that I have a few more questions coming here. Should we get a diagnosis and prognosis from the specialist? I was referred to a physiotherapist, but I never got a written diagnosis or prognosis. And that is a very good question. Physiotherapists do not diagnose. Physiotherapists will work with you based on your presentation. Physiotherapists can, and the good ones, the well-trained ones, they will make a working hypothesis and will help the medical doctor, whichever specialist you're seeing, it will help them, it will guide them in that search. So for instance, if you go to a knowledgeable physiotherapist and have a history of migraines and vestibular migraines, and you go to this knowledgeable physiotherapist with that history and that presentation, that specialized physiotherapist may say to your family doctor, to your referring doctor, look, I think that it is worthwhile exploring whether this dizziness may have a relationship with migraines. So the physiotherapist will work with the medical doctor in order for the medical doctor to then kind of seal the deal and label it. But that's how it goes. The same goes for the vestibular audiologist. We do diagnostic vestibular testing, meaning the diagnosis of, for instance, you have a bilateral vestibular hypofunction or a bilateral vestibular disorder. This is a diagnosis that an audiologist can make. as much as I can say to you, you have a sensory neural hearing loss, I can say to you, oh, you have a loss of balance function. If this was caused by Meniere's disease, the doctor will say, not the audiologist. I will not label the disease, but I will say, here, your balance sensors seem to be working just 50%. There is a dysfunction on this and that balance sensor. That is within the scope of practice of the vestibular audiologist, okay? Someone asked, what does it signify if gravel alleviates symptoms? Gravel is a drug that acts on the central nervous system, and it is a sort of a numbing agent, if you will. It reduces the sensitivity of your central nervous system, and it usually works very well at reducing nausea. So it is a symptomatic medication, and it will not tell you why you are having nausea and what is the reason. So the fact that it responds to gravel is good for you because you have less symptoms, but you have to continue to dig deeper to understand why you're having nausea. Just someone saying, not a question, but just confirming how complex the system is to navigate someone who has dizziness, vertigo, and tinnitus, and I persevere and believe that the person will find answers. And I thank you for sharing that. And it prompts me to say that if you have not found the answers that you need, you are entitled to have a second opinion, or sometimes a third opinion. It is, and I took a deep breath here to say that I know how draining this can be. I know how disabling this can all be and how draining it is for you to say in seeing people dealing with this for more than 25 years, people tell me, you are specialist number 7, you're a specialist number 5. And I know the effort and the pain and sometimes the suffering that can come with you searching and searching and searching and never finding. So we at Balance and Dizziness Canada, we want to inspire, support, and educate you and hopefully better equip you at keep searching for this. Sometimes even the specialists will say, you know, I cannot write down, I don't know what it is, but here, this is a direction for you to explore. And what I will say to you very importantly is, when you are given a direction to follow, so for instance, the person who asked me about vestibular migraines. So if you have been given this direction, well, I think it is vestibular migraines. What would I suggest to you to do is follow that path. And sometimes you have to follow that path for a good 2-3 months. Do your very best, follow the suggestions, explore that path for a while. For, as I say, 2 months to 3 months is a reasonable amount of time for you to explore, give it a fair try. And for you to then at the end of that time, stop and say, how much did I improve? Was this helpful to me or not? Is this my path to recovery? And you may find that, oh, you know what? I am not cured, but compared to where I started, I am noticing improvement here. I think that I am moving in the right direction. This is moving in the right direction. My suggestion to you then is to follow your path. Reason why I'm saying this is just sometimes you're going to be given a few different directions. And this can drive you even more ballistic than if you were not given any direction. And you may sometimes try this and that and the other thing and all at the same time, making it harder for you and for your specialists to really determine what is helping, what isn't helping, and which one is the most likely answer here for me? Which one is really my path? As cheesy as it may sound to you that you have a path to recovery, this is exactly what it is. Reason being that, again, if you have Meniere's disease, there is a path that we know is recommended, and it has been shown by research that is the path that is helpful. And it is a completely different path than if you have, say, a tumor. So you do need to know more or less, you do have to narrow down, you do have to rule things out and narrow down to a few different hypotheses, and then follow that path for a while and see where it takes you. At the same time, if you have been following a path for 6 months, a year and a half, and 2 years, and that has not led you to improvement or to feeling that you are managing your condition well, I would recommend you to stop and reassess. Vestibular rehabilitation, for instance, is not something that you should be having for a year and a half, 2 years, 3 years. We know that there is a certain amount of retraining in the brain that can occur, but it should not take long, that long. So if you have a dizziness and you have been in vestibular rehabilitation for a year and a half, my suggestion to you is to take a step back and perhaps go back to the drawing board and reassess. How is it that this process has not led to significant improvement in a year and a half? Obviously, if you have, for instance, a balance disorder that has been caused by Parkinson's disease, and you know that the nature of Parkinson's disease is to go into a degeneration, obviously you are going to go through physiotherapy for your Parkinson's disease for an extended period of time, but then you know that that is the path. What I am saying is, for instance, I've been diagnosed with BPPV and I've had maneuvers for 4 months. Those two things do not jive. So if I have had maneuvers for more than 2 or 3 sessions, stop, take a step back and reassess. So again, the diagnosis may inform you whether you are on the right track for recovery or not. Vestibular audiologist did not give me a written diagnosis or prognosis. The vestibular audiologist will give you a report of the results. On those results, it will say, so for instance, if you have had a VEMP testing, and that VEMP testing will say your utricle and saccule are within normal range, that is the diagnosis of the vestibular audiologist. Or your water test was normal or abnormal, that is the written diagnosis of the vestibular audiologist. And you should pursue getting those reports for you and getting an understanding of what those reports mean, because those are diagnostic testing of the inner ear. As well as having your hearing test, you should have a copy of your hearing test, because that is a diagnosis of your hearing. Went to an ENT for hearing loss and dizziness and got a CT, but he did not see a major reason. That is a very interesting question. And what is the role of imaging in diagnosis of vestibular disorders? I will make an analogy between vision or hearing again and the balance sensors. So for instance, when you go for an MRI, it shows your eyeball on the MRI, and the doctors will see whether your eyeball and the nerve, the optic nerve, the nerve coming from your eyes, whether they show well on the picture, whether the structure is intact. Or when you do a CT scan, for instance, they will look as to whether the orbital bone has been fractured or is intact or not. But that MRI or that CT will never tell you if you have a vision problem, if you need glasses or not. Same is valid for hearing and dizziness and the balance sensors in the inner ear. When you go for a CT or an MRI of your temporal bone, of the ear bone and the head, we are looking for major structural abnormalities. Most of the time, we are looking at the health of the hearing and vestibular nerve, the health of the bone, whether the bone is intact, and whether there are any tumors on the nerve and on the structures on the back of your head here. So the role of the CT and the MRI is to rule out structural causes for your dizziness and balance disorders. There is a common cause for hearing loss and not common, but one of the causes would be an acoustic neuroma or vestibular schwannoma. It's a tumor that grows around the hearing and balance nerve, and it will show on an MRI. And this can produce hearing loss and dizziness. So the doctors needed to know about that. But for many other causes, we cannot know from the MRI and from the CT if the tiny sensors are working or not. So then CT and MRI will rule out or rule in certain structural issues, but will not necessarily give you the final diagnosis. For instance, there are no tests that will diagnose vestibular migraine. It wouldn't show on a CT or an MRI. So that is usually one step in understanding what is happening with you, but not everything.
Thanks, Erica. That's all the time we have for
questions today. That is all the time we have for today. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much for sharing your expertise on navigating the Canadian healthcare system. We did receive some questions that were not related to the topic today of navigating the healthcare system. And we just want to let you know that these will be answered when we have an expert hour session on that topic. And there will be more coming up, one in June and some more in the fall. So thank you all for attending today's talk. We really encourage you to visit our website for more information about balance and dizziness disorders, as well as if you're not already a member, to become one or make a donation. We need your help to continue our series of free of charge online information sessions like this one. Please join us for our next session that will be coming up in June. It will be on vestibular rehabilitation, and there will be information on our website about it and how to join as well. Go to the upcoming events page. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.